These days, it feels like you'd have to be living on the moon to avoid the concept of wellness, a word that seems to be everywhere. And whilst I like to think that I've always had a pretty balanced lifestyle, my conscious efforts to be healthy have suddenly skyrocketed. Obviously, this is great news, but there is one tiny problem, in that I don't really have a clear idea of what wellness is all about. And as a result, I find myself lost in the supplement aisle, unmotivated at the gym, and buried in piles of conflicting information. So this series will follow my personal quest to demystify the world of wellness. I'm going to be meeting with experts in the fields of health and human behavior to try and get to the bottom of what wellness actually is. And with their wisdom safely in my basket, I'll be testing out the theory on my mind, body, and soul in the hopes of finding out what on earth is wellness. If you want to join me on this journey, subscribe to the British Vogue YouTube channel to ensure you never miss an episode. I moved from New York City to LA earlier this year, gave up most of my vices and unhealthy habits, and dove headfirst into all Los Angeles had to offer. From cryogenics to aura readings, to vitamin injections to crystal baths, if it's meant to do me good, I'm there with bells on. So I guess a big part of this journey for me is evaluating this blind enthusiasm for all things well, in the hope of improving upon my current kid in a candy store approach. Obviously, Los Angeles is just like wellness capital. And you know, if someone tells me it's good, then I'm gonna try it out. I'm kind of a sucker for that. And it's sort of embarrassing that I'll get full like vitamin IV drips like in my veins. Maybe I am kind of overdoing it. You know, I'm trying just to make up for years of me not making the best well choices. Wellness was introduced to me pretty early on in life. I think my mom is a pretty typical well person. You know, she was brought up here in California in the 70s, and I feel like that's kind of when that all started, that awareness of wellness. And growing up in France, I could tell it was a little bit different. Like, none of my friends had ever seen a smoothie before, and she was really into smoothies and sprouts and wraps. So pretty healthy base. Then I moved out of my parents' house, and then it was still, I think, pretty healthy in France. I think it's quite easy to be healthy there. And then it's when I moved to New York, I was definitely a lot less healthy there. You know, being away from home and trying to meet new people and going out a lot. In France, my ex-boyfriend and I would go out. I think Tuesday nights were our nights where we'd like, you know, we'd go to like a cute little restaurant. It was like such a big deal. And in New York, everybody goes out all the time. So you don't know what you're eating really because you didn't cook it. I became terrified of being alone there, which is really odd. I was constantly had to go out, and I used to cherish being alone so much. And so just at one point I decided, I was like, this is just not making me as happy as I'd like to be, and I need to like reconnect with me. So I came out here and I'm turned into a grandmother. I go to bed really early and I wake up early, and I, you know, go to yoga and I meditate, and I've become cliche Los Angeles grossness, but I love it and it works for me. And yeah, it's really just a journey for me of trying to achieve like total wellness and happiness. Are you filming this?
Most of my friends quit smoking. Everybody kind of wants me to quit, but also they're like, we can't imagine you without a cigarette in your mouth. It's like become who you are, and that's so sad. And I think about it all the time. I'm like, my God, it's like, it is, it's my thing. What if I don't have that thing anymore? It's so depressing. I wish my thing was something else. I know that I'm probably gonna get a lot of shit for, you know, doing a show about wellness and being a smoker, and I, you know, and then probably all these people we're gonna meet are gonna give me a hard time about it, and I'm ready for it. Bring it on. Make me feel terrible, because I don't know why I'm still doing it.
To gain some perspective on this current healthy living craze, I wanted to learn a little more about the history of wellness and how the term emerged into the mainstream. Luckily enough, Dr. John Travis, founder of the world's first wellness center, is still active in the field and kindly flew down to help us out with a little wellness history.
The good old days. We had parties with our clients and staff. This is our biofeedback practitioner hugging one of our clients. So it was touchy-feely in the 70s. It was in that little house, downtown Mill Valley, the kind of ghetto of wealthy people. I figured if people have reached material success and they're not happy, maybe they'll try something else and they can afford to pay for it.
So how did the wellness center originate?
My dad was a country doctor in a small farming town, and I loved how people loved him. So I thought, well, when I grow up, I want to be a doctor like my daddy. I was age 5, it was about 1948. And interestingly, that's the same year the World Health Organization published their statement of that health is much more than the absence of disease. That inspired Halbert Dunn, who wrote the book High Level Wellness. That was the Bible. And this little book was written in 1961. I found it in 1971. And it changed my life. It was like, wow, that's what I want to do.
High-level wellness was an overlooked wellness Bible penned in 1961 by a rogue American doctor, Halbert Dunn, who campaigned for a new understanding of health as a positive thing rather than simply an absence of disease. Way ahead of its time, the book taught that wellness was achieved through a holistic approach, including not only the mind, body, and spirit, but also environment and community.
I summarize all my work with 6 words. The currency of wellness is connection. We're connected with people, we're connected with the physical world, with the mental, emotional world, with our sense of the divine, all of those connections. And so much of the negative things that people get into that they would come to see us about, from alcoholism or any kind of addiction or violence or depression, they're all based on lack of connection. So if we focus on connection and a healthy connection, everything else drops out. It's fundamental to me, and that's where I've gone with wellness.
So it seems as though wellness was kind of, you know, a movement in the 70s, and now it's turned into such an industry. And how do you feel about that? Do you think it's positive or?
Well, there's both sides of it. You've got to generate income. So I don't blame people for generating income. And now that the word is popular, of course, everyone, you know, there's a wellness center on every corner. But I've been fighting a 30-year battle to get Halbert Dunn's ideas out into the world. And now if you Google wellness, you get a dog food. What he set out for wellness in the 50s when he wrote it,
right,
we still aren't there. We're not even close.
Oh, really?
No. It turned into an industry. Now it's selling products. And
totally.
When you have a problem, you have to treat it. But you don't treat wellness. You learn and grow and expand.
I think, you know, myself included, people just want results so fast.
Well, it's the medicalization of wellness that happened in the 80s. And it's you know, commercialism. And it's a natural process of ideas get put out. And then how do we make money on them? And people are making money on it, but it's lost the flavor that Halbert Dunn identified. Wellness was not a lucrative business. My first wife was expecting me to be a rich doctor, and that didn't work, and neither did our marriage.
Snorted away.
A snort break.
Two little piggies talk about wellness.
Before starting out on my journey, I wanted to check in with another Californian wellness pioneer, a woman who's got a lot to answer for when it comes to how I turned out. My first wellness coach, my mom.
She's got the longest legs. Story of my life trying to catch up with her always. So we're in Long Beach, which is where you grew up.
Yeah.
Born and raised. I would come here in the summers.
It was important for me to have my French-born daughter have as much as California in her as possible.
And I think I feel very connected to California. I think it makes sense that at this point in my life, I've come back here. I think I've always really liked it. And I have a very strong California gene of yours.
Good,
right?
It worked.
I mean, you are a huge influence on me in terms of wellness. How did you embark on your wellness journey? And
so arriving in high school, when you start making choices, I became a vegetarian and started reading all the books that everybody's reading still today.
Because it's kind of trendy in the 70s.
Yeah, surfer hippies were into eating well and starting to meditate and fast and do things like that. And I always kept that. And I like to think that I brought it to you and into your life.
I love the story of you in Long Beach and the Jack in the Box, that food chain.
This is like in 71, and it was right on the coast, and Jack in the Box at the time had these big tall heads that you could find Jack in the Box of fast food from far away. And we thought it was ruining the line of the sea. I don't know how it went, but we got the head lowered, and actually I noticed it's not even the head anymore. It's a square with a little clown on it that says Jack in the Box.
Corporations, man. You know, moving from here to Paris, there must have been a huge gap.
When I moved there, there wasn't the fast foods that there are now.
Yeah.
That's something that's new there. And the food is fresher than here.
Yeah.
I was in heaven.
Yeah.
It was like one big health food store. When I arrived, there was nobody overweight. Everybody walks, everybody eats 3 meals a day. They don't snack because they enjoy their meals, and I think that is happiness.
What do you think I can improve, and what would you like me to learn?
I think loving every bit of yourself and your road that you've traveled up to now, forgiving anything, accepting everything, and being happy where you're at right now so that you can be ready for the next step and just living right now.
Yay!
I like to think that I eat a pretty balanced diet, yet I still have a sizable selection of vitamins and supplements. And truth be told, I'm not entirely sure what they're all for.
Here are my supplements.
Which is why I've called in an expert to help me navigate these complex aisles. Dr. Molly Maloof is a pioneer in the relatively new field of scientific wellness. Based in Silicon Valley, she uses medical technologies to create bespoke wellness solutions for her clients.
I believe personalized scientific wellness is the medicine of the future, and there isn't one diet that suits all people.
Luckily for me, she gave me a private consultation in the comfort of my own home.
All right, supplements. I don't know where to start. These are things I take fairly regularly. There's more.
Okay. B vitamins and all these things like diindolmethane and turmeric and green tea, all these come from food.
Right.
So I recommend getting lots of cruciferous vegetables. Kale, broccoli, collard greens, all the green things basically, all the green vegetables will replace this in a lot of ways. So I look at food first and then supplements for specific problems that you're trying to deal with over a specific period of time.
So you sent me a questionnaire to fill out about like my health and lifestyle and all that stuff. So I filled it out.
Right.
I'm kind of nervous to go through it with you, but also super excited.
Well, it's not like good or bad. It's more of looking at different levels of vitality and helping you identify what's your priority to focus on. So in your case, do you know what your adrenals are?
You know what? I have one of my supplements is adrenal health because
Perfect.
Someone's like, you need that, but I don't know exactly what it is.
Adrenals are these master glands on the top of our kidneys, And they're really important because there's this, have you heard of the concept of fight or flight or the sympathetic nervous system? No? So let's say you're running away from a saber-toothed tiger. You need to push out norepinephrine and epinephrine, these hormones, to give you the energy to run away from something. But the problem is that modern life is really stressful. Mm-hmm. And we are always running away from things that actually aren't that stressful, but we are interpreting them as stressful. And whether it's actually even things that we don't even realize are stressful are happening, whether it's eating too much sugar, or it's smoke actually can affect our adrenals, or it's toxic relationships. I mean, right. All these things are things that really make a big difference. So I would say that based on the questions that you answered, stress is probably your biggest issue. And I would say that your sleep is definitely contributing to that too. If you're not sleeping well, that's gonna throw off your hormonal balances. Right. And if you don't sleep well, then your cortisol levels, they stay high. And that means that your stress levels are gonna be higher. You answered some questions around craving carbohydrates and getting tired after big meals. Yeah. And all of that tells me that you might have some issues with metabolizing carbohydrates right now. And that can happen when you're under a lot of stress. And eating more than 50% of your calories after 5 p.m., what's going on during the day?
When I'm busy and stuff, I don't always eat breakfast. Mm-hmm. If I'm running around, then I kind of forget, and then I'll right. have lunch around. So I'll have like my first meal around 3.
Wow.
And then kind of eat a lot and then still get hungry, like, you know,
and
in the evening.
And probably get tired after that too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then like, and because when I feel sluggish, then I go home uh-huh. and it's late and then I just eat.
Yeah. So I think that one of the big takeaways for young women is that by skipping meals on a regular basis, you're actually putting your body under a lot of stress. So getting regular meal times, believe it or not, will make a huge difference in your entire body's rhythm.
Even if it's just a little bit.
Even if it's just a little something. Evolutionarily speaking, women are designed to have kids, and our body's hormones are designed to prepare us to do that and to feed them when we have them. And so we're not like men. Men are kind of designed to go off and go hunt. And they can handle fasting a lot better than we can. A lot of these things you wouldn't need if you actually focused on regular sleep and regular meal timing and managing your stress better. These are gonna help mitigate some of the symptoms, but you always wanna get to the root cause.
Totally.
So let's talk about the elephant in the room, which is smoking, right?
Yes, I'm a smoker. I'm a pretty heavy smoker, and
really?
I have been for a while.
How heavy?
I smoke a pack a day.
Wow.
And I have been since I was 16, so.
Wow.
Yeah, 10 years.
So what's your motivation to quit? Just like 1 to 10?
5.
5.
So many people tell me that like put a cigarette in the mouth and they're like, I hate it so much, I'm still doing it. I don't have that.
Yeah. Until you actually learn to manage the triggers, it's gonna be really hard for you to manage the quitting, right? Like, you have to replace a bad habit with a good habit. And for a lot of people, it's starting to exercise, it's starting to meditate. It's like, you can't really stop something until you pick something else up.
So how long does it take for the effects of me smoking for a long time to kind of leave my body?
I would say that a lot of people notice in a year. I mean, even in a month, you're gonna notice a difference.
Right.
In a year, you're gonna feel like a different person. You really will like age backwards for about a year if you quit. Like, you will find yourself looking younger for the next year, which is pretty cool. Mm,
it is pretty
right?
cool. I feel like I just had a cigarette and my throat hurts.
Listen to your body.
I know, what is wrong with me?
You know, it's an addiction.
It is.
It's a real addiction.
Yeah.
And I think that the first thing you gotta do is, you gotta like talk to yourself nicer. Instead of saying to yourself, what's wrong with me? You have to be compassionate to yourself. Because that's the first way that you can start changing is when you really love yourself enough to say, wow, I like love myself so much that I don't want to do this to myself.
We're heading to downtown Los Angeles to meet with Danielle, who is a psychologist and expert in eating disorders. Obviously, food is a huge part of wellness. I see it with a lot of my friends, myself included. We all get so obsessed with eating healthy that it becomes kind of unhealthy. And I'm like comparing myself to girls that are 18 years old and
people want me to still look that way, but I'm, you know, 10 years older than that, and there's no way I am gonna look that way. And so I feel like it's really hard, because then you start developing body dysmorphia.
Hi, how's it going?
Hi, I'm Dr. McCurdy McKinnon. Welcome.
Thank you so much.
Follow me.
Do you kind of see a link between just like the wellness industry and people being more aware of wellness in general and eating disorders?
Yes, for sure. You know, something recently added to the nomenclature of eating disorders, which is orthorexia. Basically, orthorexia is the obsession more with the quality of food rather than an anorexia. It's more the quantity of food. So for example, someone with orthorexia, you know, may get stuck on different information that they've been given, all in good nature from the wellness industry, you know, say that processed sugars are bad. That's a really, really common one. And yes, processed sugars aren't great in large amounts,
right.
But people will kind of be off to the races and eliminate, you know, anything with any sugar and eventually become malnourished, possibly because suddenly, oh, it's not just sugar, but it's also flour that I can't have, even whole grains. And, you know, before they know it, they're down to eating just vegetables, for example. Clean eating is another thing that you often hear about. And what's the opposite of clean? Dirty. And so there's these words that people use that can really have an effect on how they feel about themselves.
I can relate to that a lot. I have a pretty balanced, healthy diet. And then sometimes I really crave a cookie. And so I'll have a cookie, I have a hard time stopping. So then I'll have a few. And then just that guilt.
Mm-hmm.
It's such an awful feeling of like, you eat something that is bad or whatever, and mm-hmm. then, yeah, it's awful.
Well, and I'm glad you bring that up, because, you know, if you aren't really, or if anyone isn't allowing themselves something, be it sugar or a cookie or whatever, oftentimes that can lead to craving it more. And then when you finally do allow yourself to have it, you overdo it. Whereas if you kind of had like, maybe a cookie every week or every few days, you'd be like, I know I'm gonna have one in a few more days.
Yeah. I feel like when I was kind of at what I think when I looked the best or felt the happiest is before I was so aware about like, you know, foods and wellness and like eating healthy. And now I'm constantly thinking about, you know, what my next healthy meal is gonna be, where I can eat it. You get so obsessive with things. Whereas when I wasn't thinking about it, I looked great and I didn't.
Yeah, and that's exactly like the slippery slope I was talking about. So the more people think about food, the more they think about food. And so part of, I think, wellness is having a broad variety of foods in your diet. You know, food rules definitely lead to more obsessional thinking and compulsive behaviors when it comes to eating and exercise too.
That's something I could never relate to though, is addicted to exercise. I wish I was a little more addicted to exercise.
Yeah, well, some people actually, you know, they talk about the runner's high and things like that. Some people are biologically predisposed to really get a lot out of exercise. Pride and willpower and all these other positive connotations that cognitively help people maintain that behavior.
So as I've mentioned before, I'm a total stress emotional eater, because it seems as though almost something shuts off and you just eat and you don't even think about it. Mm-hmm. And then when I come back to my senses, I'm like, what did I do? Mm-hmm. So how do you control that?
The best way to control it is to eat healthy amounts of food regularly.
Right.
So by eating frequently and normal amounts, you're going to be a lot less likely to overeat. But as far as stress eating, mindful eating is really important, kind of slowing down, thinking about what you want to have, planning ahead. So saying, you know, this next snack or meal, I'm feeling particularly emotionally vulnerable, so I'm going to have X, Y, and Z, and plan it out and put it on your plate and don't watch TV and eat it mindfully, enjoy it. And then if you do overdo it, don't say disparaging things to yourself, because then that just kind of creates the vicious cycle of self-doubt. And, you know, when I was a teenager and in college, the best my body ever was, I actually like my body so much more now. And it's just, I wish so much that young girls could get to that place so much younger in life and realize the amount of energy that's wasted and the negative effects of being so mean to yourself and saying mean things to ourselves. Like, how can we expect other people to love us and care about us and think positive things of us if we can't even do that for ourselves?
That's a nice message. Mental well-being is a huge part of the wellness puzzle, but as a largely invisible entity, it's notoriously hard to measure or manipulate. At UCLA, a team of researchers are addressing that challenge, working with advanced imaging tools to map brain activity.
Can you tell how much of my brain cells I've fried by being silly in my youth?
Do you want me to take your Instagram photo now? Or?
Oh my God.
I began my day with the frankly terrifying challenge of having my brain photographed in an MRI scanner.
You know, I'm a little nervous.
Great, I see your brain right now.
I only lasted a few minutes in the machine, so my photos were lacking detail. But seeing a perfect rendering of my brain was still pretty mind-blowing.
We have these very, very pretty pictures. I find them pretty.
Oh my gosh.
To, for example, show you slices of your brain, sort of in context of the rest of your head.
Using this kind of technology, researchers are able to see the physical, real-time effects of all kinds of phenomena on the brain, from getting high off Instagram likes to fighting stress with meditation.
I'm coming back next week.
Yeah, okay, that's
so
a good plan.
So I keep telling everyone that
that's
I
a good
meet.
Plan.
I wanted to find out if this research could help me identify priorities in my own attempts to be well. So I sat down with neuropsychologist Dr. Robert Bilder.
Hi.
Well, hello there.
Alongside his research in brain structure and function, Dr. Bilder heads up MindWell, an initiative that promotes wellness of mind, brain, and spirit across the UCLA campus.
You know, we're trying to promote people having that kind of balance in their lives and really focus on the things that are important, like what is sustained happiness. I don't know if you ever heard of the term eudaimonia.
No.
It's a term Aristotle used to describe a certain kind of happiness. So it's easiest to understand if we contrast it to the other kind of happiness that Aristotle also defined, which is hedonia. So hedonia is the immediate kind of gratification and happiness that comes from satisfying one of the basic urges. So you've heard of the four Fs, feeding,
right,
fighting,
right,
fleeing, and reproductive behavior. Those are the things that go into hedonic kind of happiness.
Yeah.
But it's been studies of the brain and studies of those systems that show that it doesn't last. It's not sustained. Some of the questions, well, how do you get sustained happiness? And it turns out identifying those things that actually have value to you and then doing those things, like mindfulness meditation.
Right.
You know, those kinds of mindfulness practices, you know, have been well associated with increased sense of well-being. It actually changes the expression of DNA in our cells and can actually alter your actual response to stress and quiet down the signals that make you feel bad.
Wow.
Yeah, it's cool, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Is it similar with like sports or?
You know, one of the things that people ask is, what's the one thing I could do? And it turns out that the best demonstrated thing you can do for your brain is to exercise.
More than meditation?
Yeah, so far. So it may be that there's just more evidence for the exercise, but part of that is driven just by increasing the oxygen flow to your brain.
Mm-hmm.
But we now know that you can grow new brain cells. So
then
the questions. Yeah, right, that's right. Well, for those of us who've lost too many, you know, you're always hoping, can we grow some more back? It turns out that one of the most reliable ways to grow new brain cells is through intensive physical activity. And you can actually see neurons and brain regions change in size and volume as a result of engaging in these kinds of activities.
Can I ask
ask a like kind of personal question? You know, people with addictive behaviors, is that something, how does your brain and like...
Yeah, so one way to think about this, it follows some of the same ideas we were talking about. So basically there's a system in the brain that matches up what we're expecting to happen with what really happens. Imagine what really happens is much better than what you expected. This part down in the brainstem secretes dopamine that dumps it into these ventral regions of the brain, these reward centers. And so they get all excited and you get the feeling of reward. You go, wow, things are much better than I thought they were gonna be.
Right.
But as soon as the excessive stimulation goes away, then they're in a withdrawal state and they feel the need to get back to that other feeling that they had before.
Yeah.
Nicotine does a particularly insidious job of creating an increase in this reward system. And then you go into a negative state very quickly, and one in which you actually want the substance just to feel normal again. And it's those systems that I think are being hijacked by social media, because they're addicting us to the feeling as if we're connected to another person. Not just one person, but maybe to tens, hundreds, or thousands of people,
right,
when the reality is it's not sustained.
I see that you have crystals in the plate.
Yes.
How do you feel about, a scientist, how do you feel about crystals?
Well, I'm 100% confident that this crystal is going to change your life forever.
Yes.
And that it's going to enhance your focus and clarity, and that you're going to achieve brain powers never dreamt of before. If you can just hold this crystal in your left hand, and now bring it to your forehead.
Oh my God.
Isn't it amazing?
Amazing.
Now, if we'd done this in a way that actually had you believing that all that stuff really works,
right,
then I think you actually could have achieved some gains in well-being. The placebo effect,
right,
which, you know, is often given a bad name in science, but the bottom line is if we can get things done and have people feel better, well, that's fantastic. There are really no side effects. So it would be great if we can channel that belief that we're going to do better. I think we can make a lot of strides in psychology.
Bob hit upon something interesting there. This idea that, regardless of objective science, simply believing in something and acting accordingly can have a profound effect. I personally have felt a connection to crystals from a young age, so in order to learn a little bit more about the device of stones, I paid a visit to Spellbound Sky to hang out with my new best friends, Mark and Martin.
Hi, Camille. How's it going,
darling?
Nice to see you.
The pink stones and the green stones are all heart-related stones, so it's all about compassion, love, kindness. So I always tell my clients, look at the crystals, don't even read what they mean, just what are you drawn to? So energetically, that's kind of the energy that you probably need.
Yeah.
It's all about co-creating your own reality.
I'll take them all.
I know, right? That's all I wear. This is another powerful way to cleanse your crystals and your energetic field also with
Do I turn it around?
It's sacred, magical smoke. It knows exactly what it's doing.
Totally.
Okay, you're cleansed.
You're cleansed.
Whoosh.
It feels so good. Thank you so much. It smells so delicious.
What is this good for?
Carnelian is good almost like a motivated mindset, confidence, courage, all those things that make you go from like you're not thinking it's going to happen to, you know what, I got this.
Yeah.
I can make this happen for sure.
Say, for example, you're in a relationship and you need to break up with this person, but you don't have the courage or you can't muster up the guts to say, you know what, I'm done with you.
Yeah.
Then you would work with a stone like this.
Just throw it at him.
So, for a complete novice, mm-hmm, how do they work? How do crystals work?
Okay. Every single crystal is a conductor of a precise frequency. You know, computers use crystals, cell phones use crystals, because they conduct frequency so precisely. Every color correlates to a different energy center.
Mm-hmm.
So for example, you work with a stone like this tangerine aura, this is all for your solar plexus. So the frequency that this crystal is transmitting to you, it's balancing and aligning your solar plexus. That's why it's a tool. After a while, when you're full of this frequency, you don't need the crystal anymore. You can put it away because you're like, oh my God, I'm running on all 8 cylinders.
Because, you know, some people are kind of like, you know, what is all this? And I'm like, I mean, regardless of what you believe in, if you pick up a crystal for a certain reason and you have it in your pocket, whenever you're going to see it, whenever you're going to touch it, you're going to be reminded of that intention.
You are definitely right. At the very beginning, you can use all of these to represent certain energies that you want to attract in your life. You'll see some people and they're like, well, I don't believe in crystals. And then they're wearing a diamond ring that they place so much significance on. And
totally.
It does represent such an intense thing.
And I mean, they're so beautiful.
Freaking gorgeous.
Look at this. You guys added the sparkles. Do you think that society is starting to just open up to, you know, all these alternative types of healing? And
of course they are. You know, we live in such a negative society and things cannot continue the way they're going. So people are saying, you know what, if I can't change the world, at least I can change myself. Mm-hmm. So by them changing themselves, one by one by one, the whole world will start waking up. At the end of the day, wellness represents being kind to yourself, loving yourself, not beating yourself up, you know, thinking positive about yourself in a balanced way. That's it. It's that simple, but it can make the biggest difference.
What are you guys wearing right now?
I'm wearing some smoky quartz, citrine, copper, some black tourmaline for psychic protection, and some more black tourmaline because I love black tourmaline.
Yeah.
Oh, and then my little Lemurian quartz crystal. Oh, and then I'm wearing some labradorite.
You can see.
You asked.
Martin belongs to the More is More Club for sure.
And this is called labradorescence.
It does sound like a drag queen's name.
Labradorescence.
Totally. I was walking around last year. I really needed some love, and I was like, God damn it, there are no boys left in New York City. And I bought a big rose quartz.
Oh, perfect.
And I had the dude mount it on a necklace. He's like, it's really big. And I was just walking around with the rock. I was like, all right, come find me, boys. It was really funny. But
it made sense to you at that time.
It
That's
did.
All that
and
matters.
You know what? I got laid. So.
Yeah. It worked.
To be mindful is the holy grail right now. And a new wave of apps are helping meditation novices learn how to get there.
Oh, Camille, nice to meet you.
Former monk Andy Puddicombe co-founded Headspace with his partner Richard Pearson in 2010. In an effort to make the practice of meditation more accessible to the world. Harnessing the power of the internet, they designed the Headspace guided meditation app.
Think of it like a gym membership for the mind. Using proven meditation and mindfulness techniques, we'll show you how to train your mind for a healthier, happier, more enjoyable life.
The app has now been downloaded by more than 7 million people worldwide.
UK, US, Canada, but these are just little notes that come in from different people.
Headspace is now expanding at a mindful rate, designing new tools to ensure their guided meditation is available to as wide an audience as possible, such as this cozy meditation booth, the ideal escape pod for a busy workplace.
What's your policy on someone that comes here a little too often?
We probably should have one, but we don't have a policy on that.
Having recently begun to dabble in meditation with varying degrees of success, I had a lot of questions for Andy.
For our viewers that maybe don't know what meditation is, do you have kind of a simple explanation to
sure.
what it is?
As a word, I think, really loaded, comes with lots of baggage, and there's often lots of misconceptions around it. And I think now it's complicated because people often use kind of mindfulness and meditation interchangeably as well.
Right.
And kind of different things. So mindfulness being kind of just present in the moment. You can do that in any moment of the day. Right now, we're sitting here kind of chatting. It might be while you're having a cup of coffee later in the day. Typically, we live our life, 50% our mind is distracted. So we're walking down the street, but we're thinking about something that just happened over there. Maybe we're driving in the car, and we're not even focused on the road. We're thinking about where we're going.
Yeah.
So we need an exercise where we step out of the busyness of everyday life and actually learn and practice that process of being more mindful, more aware. And that's all meditation is.
So I downloaded the app and I was, you know, doing it every morning, first thing in the morning, and then I didn't do it one day, and then you fall off of it.
Yeah. It's really common.
Yeah. How do you
stay on the wagon, I think?
Stay on the wagon.
I think the first thing is to reflect on what your motivation is for doing it. Because if it's just kind of like, I just kind of want to feel better, it's probably not clear enough and we're unlikely to kind of stay motivated. I think it's also really important to remember kind of how long it takes to develop a new habit. So we're talking about a couple of months of doing something every day on a consistent basis to really develop that as a habit and a routine. Right. And then something called coupling. So like, let's say you have a shower every morning. Okay, so it becomes shower and meditation. Or let's say you have a cup of tea every morning. Cup of tea and meditation. So it's not time specific. You don't say, right, 7 o'clock every morning, I'm going to do it. Because then at the weekend comes, 7 o'clock in the morning, you're fast asleep. But you will probably still at the weekend have your shower or have your morning cup of tea. And if it's in your mind, okay, I do this and then I do my meditation, then it's more likely
Cigarette meditation,
yeah. Breathing in through the mouth and out through the nose.
I'm kidding.
You know, I know you are kidding.
Yeah.
But I think there's an idea, and I think it's a shame. I think there is an idea that to meditate, you have to live a super clean life, and you know, you shouldn't be smoking, shouldn't be drinking coffee, and kind of these other things that we're advised kind of not to do so much of. Of course, if you go out and get absolutely hammered the night before, you're probably not gonna have that much clarity in your meditation the next morning, you know? But personally, I would say to someone, even if they do smoke, why not?
Yeah.
Do what you do. I think over time, those things just become less attractive the more you meditate.
You know, that's kind of what I'm thinking, that like cigarettes are just gonna one day just be really gross to me.
Yeah, I just don't think they'll feel kind of so appealing.
Do you get the same benefits from meditating 10 minutes as you do meditating for an hour?
Like, I think the most important thing is quality rather than quantity. In the same way that when you're training the body, you wouldn't kind of go out and run a marathon straight away. You'd kind of you build up slowly. It's really important with meditation that you build up slowly. More of the recent research found that as little as 20 minutes a day in just 5 days is already having a physiological impact on the brain.
So there's a lot of scientific research.
There is now. So until about maybe 15 years ago, the assumption was that the brain kind of grows older, gets to a certain stage, and then we just start to kind of degenerate over time.
Yeah.
Probably about 12 years ago, they started bringing monks over from Tibet, and they started looking at what was happening in their brains during meditation. And what they found was that the brain is actually changing. It's not just like a psychological feeling better, the brain is changing. So before it was kind of, it's quite hard to describe, and it's just like, I don't know how, I don't know why, but I feel better. And now we can kind of actually see why we feel better. I do think the biggest misconception about meditation is that it's only for oneself. And some people even kind of think that it's a bit selfish, you know? There are people who need help in the world. Why not go and help them rather than sit with your eyes closed? I get that kind of the sentiment, but I sincerely hope that this has a positive kind of impact on the people around me in my life. Really basic, simple way of thinking about it. If one day we forgot to meditate, we're just caught up in stuff. We just let the door slam on the person behind us. They're walking around holding their head, they're feeling angry. Like in their head, they have a story about you all day long. They're being angry at the people around them, they're being angry around. Instead, you did your meditation, you're aware, you held the door open, the person came through, oh, that's nice. Those kind of like little ripple effects, I feel are beautiful. Like that is how the world becomes a happier kind of place. It's with all these little things that every single one of us have a responsibility to do, I think.
Oh, it's so beautiful. It's interesting because I was thinking of it as first as something like very personal and thinking of myself as an individual and wellness like as an individual.
Yeah.
And meditation's a little bit like that. But then you were just talking about community and I was gonna say I feel like they should teach it in schools.
Yeah, we've got Headspace for Kids coming out. So we ran a pilot in schools, public schools last year. The feedback was that they did feel kind of calmer. Like one little girl said her mind kind of felt softer and a little bit fuzzy, you know? And kind of the qualities they were describing are, I think, the qualities we would want to pass on to the next generation. Why would we be focusing more on teaching children trigonometry than kindness and connecting with others and happiness? There is an assumption that they'll just happen in life. But we just have to look around us in society to see they don't just happen for everybody. If we're not talking about that, people who are struggling don't have permission to talk about it. If you look at the predictions from the National Institute of Health in America, are that within 10 years, the cost of mental illness is going to be more than cancer, diabetes, and respiratory illness combined at a global cost of $6 trillion. So, like, I think for a long time, it's just been either swept under the carpet, like, it's just something we don't really kind of want to talk about, we want to address, and I think a lot more needs to happen for that to become really socially acceptable, where we do. We talk about our minds in the same way that we talk about our bodies, and through that, kind of hopefully find a place that feels comfortable and happy in our mind.
It's common sense when you think about it, but the health of our community doesn't pop up that often in mainstream wellness conversation. Yet feeling connected to those around us plays a huge role in our sense of well-being. So perhaps taking the time to mindfully engage with your fellow citizens could be just as good for you as hitting the gym.
So we're headed to LA Kitchen in downtown Los Angeles. It's a nonprofit that kind of helps train vulnerable peoples of the community to learn how to cook or become chefs with an emphasis of, you know, health for everyone.
Here you can see the full kitchen.
Wow, it's beautiful.
I know. All our food is made from scratch, so we don't have anything processed, nothing frozen, nothing canned. So you might have heard of like imperfect foods and things
right.
like that. So people, you know, are so obsessed with cosmetically perfect foods, but the food is just totally okay. And so we make the meals out of them and donate it to people who need meals.
That's amazing.
Yeah. So through our three programs, the Empower program, where we have the culinary job training program, which is a 15-week culinary job training where men and women come out of prisons and jails who are interested in the culinary field, basically a second chance to really, you know, excel and flourish in that field. And we hire them into our social enterprise, Strong Food, and we pay them above minimum wage and everyone gets benefits. And that's typically unheard of in the culinary, like the food industry.
Right.
Yeah.
So people can volunteer as well?
Yeah, definitely. Through the volunteer program, our impact program, people can come and volunteer and make the meals for the different agencies that we serve. So homeless agencies, needle exchange agencies, donating those foods. We just welcome as many volunteers as possible. Please.
And then what kind of feedback do you get from the volunteers?
People just have so many different experiences and of how rewarding it is, because knowing that this food would have gone to waste and you're utilizing it, preparing a meal and giving it to someone who doesn't have a meal.
It's so inspiring. You know, we're doing a show about wellness and it just it just seems that what we're getting from it is it's all very personal.
Yeah.
And it shouldn't be. It should be about community.
Exactly. And in every community, there are these social problems. And we're willing to share what we have because, you know, it's not about us. It's really about the community. I mean, I love going to work every day. I love coming here. I love everything about what we do.
That's so awesome.
I mean, how could you not?
All right. We are going into the kitchens to meet Teresa, the lead cook. And I have to put a hairnet on, yeah. Teresa!
Hi.
How's it going? I'm
Fine.
Camille. So nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Should I be wearing gloves too?
No.
All right. What kind of things do you like to cook?
I like stews.
Stews?
I love stews.
You're a stew master?
Yes, Moroccan stew, beef stew.
Yum.
So those are my best.
That's amazing.
We did a short rib brine, and these are the juices from it.
Oh, this made me so hungry.
I wish we had smell-o-vision.
I like what I'm seeing. I'd have all of it.
Exactly.
Oh, yum. You guys are torturing me.
And that will be a healthy peach cobbler.
Healthy peach cobbler.
Yes.
So can you tell us a little bit about your story? Because you've been here from the very beginning,
yes.
Right? So how did it all come about?
They had a flyer out about LA Kitchen's culinary program, right up my alley. I love to cook. So I applied, was accepted, and
you've been here ever since.
I've been here ever since.
And how long have you been? Because you're lead cook.
Yes.
So you're the boss.
I don't look at it as a boss because I feel that we're a team.
Yeah.
So I work side by side with my colleagues.
And so how many people are you cooking for?
I have a number, I believe, of 503 people. I'm cooking some asparagus. I blanch them, and we drop them down in some ice water, and it keeps them bright to green and nice and crispy.
Amazing. I know, they look so appetizing.
They're very good.
Do you feel like there's a connection between, you know, having a healthy, balanced diet, eating healthy foods, and just having a healthy mind and spirit?
Yes, very much. When you're eating healthy food, you feel better. Therefore, you think better. And I find that with my cooking, I feel who I'm cooking for. Therefore, they're getting the same thing.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
What about the students and the trainees? Like, what kind of effects have you noticed on their lives? Does it change people's lives, right?
Oh, I've seen it change a lot of people's lives. Sometimes you come with no hope because your past tells you you don't have any hope. It tells you that your life is limited. And with LA Kitchen, it's not limited. It wasn't limited for me. I thought that one time myself. It's very possible for anybody that comes through this program, regardless to what their past is, for them to be very successful in this and to be very successful in their lives. We're a family. So we're happy for each other with the advancements in our lives. And I'm grateful to be a part of that experience.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much.
I love to dance, so when I heard about Five Rhythms, a meditation practice based around movement and music, I immediately signed up. The night before the class, we headed up to Topanga Canyon to meet my teacher, Kate Shela.
Lovely to see you.
Lovely to see you.
Who shared a little of her wisdom about the healing power of dance.
Mind the steps in your heel.
Yeah.
Topanga is a real renegade canyon. I think it really attracts reclusive artists that are very much involved in the world, but they want to return to a place that they get cocooned by. And I think throughout history, every kind of artist and performer that you can mention from the 60s and 70s has lived here at some point.
Can you tell me about Five Rhythms? Like, where does it come from? What is it? Because I have no idea what I'm getting into. But I'm so excited.
That's even better. I mean, I actually think the less people know about things, the better in a way.
Because so should then I not
it's experiential.
Know? I mean,
what you need to know is you're going to be dancing for 2 hours solidly, and I'm DJing all different kinds of music right. And creating a landscape for you and the group to drop into whatever needs to be attended to. So some people come to the practice because they want to meet people. Some people come because they want to lose weight. Some people come because they're really suffering and the dance allows them to transform that. People from all walks of life, doctors, surgeons, recovering addicts, people that have just been diagnosed with cancer, people coming out of prison, I mean, just ordinary folk and extraordinary folk. And you play amazing music and you ask them to move their feet. Within seconds, they know what's going on with themselves. I'm awkward, or actually I'm ragingly angry, or I've got no energy, I'm really dangerous.
Right.
But it takes a lot of courage. You know, what's asked of people is come into a room and you haven't taken drugs and you haven't had anything to drink and you're not drinking a cup of coffee.
Right.
And you've got to have your eyes open and you're going to be asked at times to dance with somebody else. It's really intimate and we're longing for it.
Yeah.
And we're terrified of it.
Yeah, it's. I mean, I love dancing so much, and my friends are always like, "Oh, Camille, but you just take up too much room, and you're too." So I get really. I kind of describe my dance style as a mix between like surfing and tai chi. Like I get really low, and I do a lot of. So anyway,
great.
So I'm pretty excited.
Excellent. Good archetypes to have.
I just have so many friends that are like, "Oh, I just don't know how to dance."
You can still come to Five Rhythms class, and you don't need to be a professional dancer, right?
God, no.
Yeah.
No. I mean, it's not a spectator sport. It's not about looking cool or good.
Right.
It's how does it feel? So the Five Rhythms were created by a woman called Gabrielle Roth, who sadly is no longer with us. She's up there with David Bowie and Prince right now having a party. Gabrielle used to say, if you can breathe, you can dance. Mm-hmm. You know, and what about if you're in a wheelchair? What, you can't dance because you've got wheels? What about if you're blind? What about if you're deaf? What about if you've got one arm? What about if you just had your breast removed? You can't dance? No. So you are guided through a moving meditation practice that really creates a wave of energy. So you're moving the whole time at your own pace, but each rhythm is almost like its own particular map. So it's not about being, you know, beautiful and perfect, like, excuse my French, but fuck that.
Yeah.
You know, life's messy.
I haven't even done it, but I am so sold. I love it. I wish there were more places where you could just go and dance and it's not about like drinking or...
Well, we know since the beginning of time, what do we know? We people danced, they made music, they shared story, and they sat around fires and they ate. And when you're not doing that, I know whoever you are, if those things aren't happening in your life, you're a pretty miserable person. That's why in Britain, everyone goes to the pub. It's like it's community or goes to a football match.
Yeah.
So for me, the dance has been going to the football match or going to the pub. It's just, I do it with people that go, because that's what wellness is about, that you feel good, that you feel connected, that you feel inspired, that you go, I need to do this, even if that's, I need to go to a dance class or actually I need to stay home and watch a really great movie today. Right. Wellness for me is, are you awake enough to be present to what you need? We've got so far away from hanging out with a stranger on a sofa and going, oh, this is really lovely.
This is so lovely.
So for me, it's very basic. The more you dance, the more serotonin you release and you get happier. It's like, oh, the hemispheres just like start to balance and you love people.
I love you. Thank you so much.
You're going to be the weeping waterfall in the middle of the room.
I'm really looking forward to tomorrow.
Me too.
So last night we met Kate at her house and kind of talked about the class that we're gonna do today. I'm really excited to do it. You know, I'm slightly worried I'm gonna be doing a lot of crying. So unfortunately, cameras are not allowed inside the dance class, so there's no like self-consciousness happening, but I'll catch up with you post 2 hour Five Rhythms dance class. Talking about, I don't know, it's really an experience. I'm really glad I did it alone. I went through a lot of different emotions. I cried a lot as predicted, but not necessarily when I thought I would cry. Kate, I was going through it. Oh my God, it's incredible.
Oh, you're so welcome.
How are you? I'm good. It's like nothing I've ever experienced. I mean, it's about dancing, but it's so much therapy, I feel. I felt like I was connecting a lot to different emotions, and then how do I express that? That thing, like looking at people, like truly looking at people, was so wild and weirdly hard for me.
It is for most people. We don't often do this except with, like, I think our children and our lovers.
Yeah.
So if you look into a stranger's eye, it's actually an act of deep intimacy, and it's terrifying. Like,
I've never done anything like this before. It was so beautiful. Thank you so much.
You're so welcome.
Thanks for coming.
Oh, thank you.
I appreciate that free-form barefoot dancing may not be for everyone, and that for many, a straight-up cardio session can work wonders for the body and mind.
Looking good.
Do I?
Yeah.
Thanks, man. I feel great.
Not my cup of tea, but all in the name of research. Looking for an alternative to the gym or expensive classes, we hooked up with Mark Hunter, founder of the free-of-charge Cobra Fitness Club.
Are there snakes?
Just the cobra snake.
Hey! I handed you that one. So, Mark.
Yes.
The cobra snake. Can you tell me a little bit about the philosophy behind Cobra Fitness Club?
I've been a party photographer slash fashion photographer for over 10 years. And over those years, I felt like shit and I gained weight and I was eating poorly and I just was lethargic and people were noticing that. And they're like, bro, what's wrong with you? You look like you're 45 and I'm 30.
Yeah.
You know, workouts can be free. They can be fun. They don't have to be at Equinox. They don't have to be at SoulCycle.
Right.
And you have the outdoors in wherever you are. It's been a few years now that I've really dedicated myself to working out, and what I want to really do is inspire other people.
So you meet up once a week.
Yeah, so I use social media. We'll post a flyer. It's open to whoever wants to show up, and it's totally random. Sometimes five people are there. Sometimes I've had hikes with almost 100 people.
Holy shit.
Look at this view.
Wow.
It was worth it, right?
Totally. So what made you choose hiking as kind of like that team activity sport? Is it because it's, I mean, obviously free and do you have more space, or do you kind of have that like Cobra Fitness Club with other?
Well, I think that what was so special about using nature is that, yeah, it is for everybody. It's a great place to meet. And it's also just like, you can watch your progress as you're going up a hill. It's not a treadmill where you're just looking at a screen watching the miles go up. Here you're like, we just climbed up this mountain and this is our reward.
Yeah.
And we also could work on our tan, make some friends, you know, bring it back to, you know, what we had before the internet.
So if I were to be part of Cobra Fitness Club and I'm kind of like, you know, checking out the flowers and slacking, what would you do? Would you call me out?
You can go at your own pace. And the thing is, you work up to a faster pace. It's not like I'm gonna expect you to jog the whole mountain with me on your first hike.
Yeah.
On your second hike, though.
Fuck.
Yeah.
Do you have any advice for someone in England, for example, that would want to start something, a project like you've done?
Basically, you need to have a consistent schedule. So once a week, every Friday, you're gonna go for a jog with your friends. Meet at a specific time and be consistent. So regardless of what happens, you still gotta show up. And then you build that. And sometimes I would host a hike and nobody came, but I knew at least I would get the workout.
Right.
So, you know, it's about keeping that consistency in your head. Also, it's important that you are welcoming of the people, because again, it is weird to meet strangers, and especially with the internet now and everybody is sort of awkward and doesn't want to like
connect
in real life. You know, you want to make sure to be welcoming to whoever might show up.
Yeah, that's really nice.
Yeah.
Cool. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Is there a elevator down? I feel like I've learned so much this week. What I'm gonna take from it, like, you know, wellness is not necessarily a selfish thing or a personal thing. It's really about community. And yeah, and connecting with others.
The currency of wellness is connection. We're connected with people, we're connected with the physical world, with the mental, emotional world, with our sense of the divine, all of those connections.
You know, speaking to all these different experts, it seems like there's just this one common message, you know, living in the present and being mindful.
Those kind of like little ripple effects, I feel are beautiful. Like that is how the world becomes a happier kind of place.
Dreamy Andy from Headspace, call me. It seems like he built a really beautiful community around his philosophy of meditation. And overall, it feels like that's another common thing between all those people. It's a lot about balance. It's all good and we're all really into it, but you can't take it too far because it becomes unhealthy.
Wellness represents being kind to yourself, loving yourself in a balanced way.
Every single person we've spoken to kind of gave me a little bit of a hard time about being a smoker.
So that kind of resonated with me. It's like, all right, I need to like kind of practice a little more self-love.
You gotta like talk to yourself nicer. Instead of saying to yourself, what's wrong with me? You have to be compassionate to yourself. Because that's the first way that you can start changing is when you really love yourself enough to say, I don't want to do this to myself.
I'm Camille Rowe, and next week, I maybe won't be smoking anymore. Maybe.
I'm so well. I'm so well. Thanks for watching this series. It's the last day. And I feel real well. 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 I feel real well. All right.